I speak in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. Greetings to each and every one of you in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and a very warm welcome to you. Thank you for listening to this reflection from the parish of St. Mary on the Limpopo on this, the 14th Sunday after Pentecost in our church's calendar. Today we continue our Sunday reflections in the season of Pentecost on how we encounter Jesus in the world around us through his teachings. And, as we have been doing these past few Sundays, today we begin by reflecting on the Gospel reading from Matthew. In last Sunday's Gospel reading, we saw Jesus cautioning his disciples that, as his followers, they would endure hardship and suffering in their lives, and that they too would face temptation. Jesus reminds us of three aspects of the cost of discipleship that we may expect to endure as his followers: the cost of selfless, self-denying service to others; second, that as we pursue this service, to be willing to bear hardship and suffering as we follow Jesus' teachings; and third, as we follow his teachings, not to put our own selfish interests before seeking to understand what is the will of God, what is right, what will further God's kingdom on earth, and then, in whatever small way we are able, to put into practice God's will. While Jesus cautions us on the personal cost of discipleship, he acknowledges that members of the Christian community may stray from time to time, and there may be divisions or disagreements between members of the church. Jesus is concerned about each one of us, and he works to bring about unity among us, striving to bring about reconciliation among community members, so that trusting, loving relationships may be restored and endure. Today's Gospel reading from Matthew chapter 18, verses 15 to 20, outlines how members of the church who have strayed may be brought back into the fold. This instruction is placed immediately after the parable of the lost sheep in Matthew's Gospel. Here, in Matthew chapter 18, verses 12 to 14, Jesus says, "What do you think a man does who has 100 sheep and one of them gets lost? He will leave the other 99 grazing on the hillside and go and look for the lost sheep. When he finds it, I tell you, he feels far happier over this one sheep than over the 99 that did not get lost. In the same way, your Father in heaven does not want any of these little ones to be lost." Matthew goes on to outline a process of three stages of reconciliation between members of a Christian community and a member who had done wrong, in order for their loving relationship to be restored. As we have noted previously, Matthew wrote his Gospel mainly for the people of a Jewish background, and the stages of reconciliation that he refers to here are founded on the Hebrew Scriptures. The first stage of reconciliation Matthew refers to should be worked out between the two people involved in private, preserving the honour and dignity of the member and maintaining the loving family atmosphere of the community. This stage may be seen to refer to Leviticus chapter 19, verses 17 and 18. "You are not to nurse hatred towards your brother. Reprove your fellow countryman frankly, and so you will have no share in his guilt. Never seek revenge or cherish a grudge towards your kinsfolk. You must love your neighbour as yourself." If the member accepts the correction, both may rejoice that a member of the family of the church had been won back to continue God's service. "But if he will not listen and he does not repent," Matthew continues, "take one or two other persons with you, so that every accusation may be upheld by the testimony of two or more witnesses." This second stage refers back to the Old Testament book of Deuteronomy, chapter 19, verse 15, that says, "One witness is not enough to convict a man of a crime. At least two witnesses are necessary to prove that a man is guilty. And if the offender will not listen to them," Matthew continues, "then tell it to the church, to the assembly of believers." And the final stage is for the offender to be excluded from the community, a drastic step to be taken only in serious matters where the welfare of the community is at stake. Such extreme action is not to be made by an individual alone, but it is to be a communal decision, where Jesus abides within the community gathered in his name, with the assurance he gives us in verse 17, "Where two or three come together in my name, I am there with them. The lesson this morning from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 13, verses 8 to 14, continues with the themes of love and reconciliation, stating in verse 9, love your neighbour as yourself, inviting us to place ourselves in the position of our neighbour and to ask how we would like to be treated in the same or similar situation. Who is my neighbour, we may ask? And at the time Jesus was living in, Jewish people understood their neighbour to mean only those who belonged to the Jewish community, the covenant community that included the children of Israel exclusively, fellow Israelites. Neighbour did not include Gentiles or sinners. But Jesus' teachings make it clear that neighbour includes all people without favour, without prejudice or discrimination on any grounds. This teaching he illustrates in the parable of the Good Samaritan from chapter 10 of Luke's Gospel. Here, a lawyer, one who had studied the laws of the Old Testament, asks Jesus the same question, but who is my neighbour? In the parable of the Good Samaritan, Jesus makes it clear that the answer was to be found in the example of the Samaritan, who showed compassion and true neighbourliness towards the man who had been set on by robbers and left at the side of the road. Samaritans were bitter rivals of the Jewish people at that time, and Jesus brings together two enemies in this story, showing us the relationship that should exist between neighbours, a relationship of love, forgiveness and reconciliation that gives us a glimpse of what we may expect the kingdom of God will be like, where enemies are reconciled and regard each other as equals. The Samaritan in the parable is Christ-like in his response to the suffering of the victim. He sees the need of another, and he cuts through all rivalries of class, of social or religious divisions that may have existed at that time, and he responds without prejudice, without regard for the circumstances and the danger he places himself in on that perilous road. The parable also challenges us to consider not who deserves to be cared for, but rather for us to become the people who treat everyone we encounter with love and compassion, however frightening, alien, naked or defenseless they may be. Love your neighbour as yourself. To strengthen us as we work towards bringing about forgiveness and reconciliation where there is division, Paul continues in our reading from Romans by inviting us to let Christ Jesus himself be the armour that you wear. Give your unspiritual nature no opportunity to satisfy its desires. Paul uses the image of Christ as the armour that we wear in other letters of his, in his first letter to the Thessalonians, for instance, where he encourages us to be armed with a breastplate of faith and love and the hope of salvation for a helmet. In his letter to the Ephesians, he inspires us to take up the armour of God, to fasten on the belt of truth, for a breastplate, put on integrity. Let the shoes on your feet be the gospel of peace, to give you firm footing, and, with all these, take up the great shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the burning arrows of the evil one. Accept salvation as your helmet, and the sword which the Spirit gives you, the Word of God. Constantly ask God's help in prayer, and pray always in the power of the Spirit. And now let us pray the collect for today. God of the Church, your Son called us to be one in you. Heal our divisions, restore our unity, and empower us for the ministry of reconciliation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we conclude with God's blessing on us. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
What do you have?